Thank you very much. Thank you very much, well, for the invitation to be here. Always a pleasure. An overview of recent case law. Someone else I need to mention and thank you first. I didn't prepare this all by myself. I was helped by Christophe Kolen, who is a PhD candidate at our Center for Consumer and Competition Law in Leuven and who helped selecting the cases for today, because there are quite a lot of them. What I'll do is just give you an overview of what happened the last year. So, September 1st, 2017 until September 17, I didn't include the very last ones. One case was already mentioned today on the notion of undertaking, which was even more recent, but you've already heard of that. But the more recent cases will be for the session of next year, so we have to come back. So quite lots of cases. Some of those cases I'll go into a little bit more depth. I'll focus on the cases on the more horizontal directives, unfair contract terms, unfair commercial practices. But we've taken a quite broad view of what is actually a consumer protection case. So we've also covered some more exotic instruments. I'll just briefly mention those other cases just to give you an idea what it's about. If I'm not mistaken, you have the cases themselves also on the USB stick, or just written? No, the cases as well. So you can easily retrieve them, and they're online, of course, as well. So, unfair contract terms. Lots of cases that keep being referred to the European Court of Justice. In my opinion, this is still a very effective instrument of consumer protection. In the first years, we didn't have that many references to the Court of Justice. In the last years, we have had lots of references with a rather active Court of Justice, imposing and requiring quite an active role of courts in Europe. And what we see is that the cases that were decided over the last year mainly concern credit contracts. So lots of references keep coming from both Eastern European states and also from Spain, where we've had a financial crisis with quite some striking case law that has effectively helped consumers and that has had huge consequences also for the banks. Most of the cases I'll come back to in a little bit more depth. There's only one case I won't deal with afterwards. That's the first one. It's a Hungarian case that concerned, well, Hungarian law, that imposed additional procedural requirements. We've had previous case law on loans, actually, that were indexed in a foreign currency, Swiss francs. And when there was a difference in exchange rate, when the Swiss franc got stronger, this, of course, put a huge burden on consumers. So there has already been case law, amongst other cases, Kassler, I don't know if you're familiar with that case, from which it followed that clauses that actually linked the amount, the installments the consumers had to pay to an exchange rate in Swiss franc could be considered not to be transparent. And could be checked on their fairness. Well, since that case law, specific legislation has been adopted in Hungary, setting out that such specific clauses are unfair, and also setting out what procedural requirements consumers had to follow if they actually wanted to invoke the nullity of the clauses or of the complete contract, and if they wanted to be reimbursed. What that legislation also asked for is that the consumer actually quantified its claim and that it said to the court which consequences it was invoking. And it was exactly that legislation that was brought before the Court of Justice, and the Court of Justice was asked whether such additional national procedure requirements could be considered contrary to the Directive on Unfair Terms, as it would, it might actually be a hinder the consumer's right to an effective remedy. The court has decided that this was not the case, that countries can also take into account the general interest, that these procedural requirements did not impose a disproportionate burden on the consumers, and that they were exactly adopted to make sure that all these cases could be dealt with in a rather swift way. So the court might be consumer friendly, but it's not so that each and every case is decided in favor of the consumer. The other cases, they deal with the general, the Andrijčić, and I'm probably pronouncing this not correctly, give more information on the general norm on how to assess the general standard of unfairness. Karel de Grote Hogeschool, it's a Belgian case. Some interesting information there are clarifications from the court on what is an undertaking. Banco Santander, that's another one that I won't come back to, concerns the possibility to assign debts. And the criteria for assessing unfairness, I will come back to that one. And I won't come back to another Banco Santander case. This case actually concerned extrajudicial enforcement procedures. So as said, quite a lot of Spanish cases have dealt with unfair clauses in mortgage contracts. Very often, either these contracts have very high interest rates or they contain floor clauses, which only allow the interest rate to vary and to increase, but not to decrease or only to a limited extent. So lots of cases have been referred to the European Court of Justice. This case also concerned mortgage procedures. And actually, the question whether a court should be able to invoke the unfairness in a procedure that followed extrajudicial enforcement procedure. So what happens if a mortgage, there are problems with a mortgage, the mortgage can be enforced, the house can be sold. Apparently, this could be done through an extrajudicial procedure. The house is then given to the highest bidder. And then afterwards, there is an additional procedure in Spain whereby the person who was actually the highest bidder has to be put in possession of that house. So the question was, like, after all these steps in the procedure, whether in that last phase the court should still be able to intervene and to invoke unfair clauses in the original contract. But the person that now is the new owner can be another person than the original creditor, so there shouldn't be, or there is not necessarily a link between the underlying contract and the actual party that obtains the property rights. So Court of Justice said no, in such a procedure there should be no possibility for the court to invoke of its own motion the unfairness of a term in the mortgage contract. There have been possibilities to do so in all the previous phases. This is about the property rights and the parties might be different. So this is not contrary to the directive on unfair contract terms. A last case still also considered credit agreements, but I'll come back to that case. Some cases also on what has been called your favorite directive. Actually, this slide might be a little misleading. Some cases that are on there actually deal with the Unfair Commercial Practices Directive. Other cases deal with more specific instruments, but that also prohibits in some way misleading presentations. Come back to Dyson and Windtree case. Princeport case was about a specific instrument. UCPD was only briefly mentioned. The court said there wasn't a misleading practice. It was actually the Verein für Lautere Wettbewerb that challenged the practice of a textile company that had some textile products which were 100% of a certain fiber. And there is a specific regulation that deals with labeling and marketing of such pure textile products. And what was actually challenged here, so that regulation says, okay, it says what is a pure textile product, so it's made of one fiber. And then the regulation says that if a pure textile product is concerned, you may refer to it as 100% or pure, or all woo, for example. And in this case, the three terms had been used. So it was invoked that this was contrary to that specific regulation. This has not been upheld. It's perfectly fine to invoke all three terms. You can use them jointly. The vacuum cleaners, we'll get back to in a minute. Europa Muur, I don't know if there is anyone here from Spain. This is another Spanish case that concerns selling at a loss. So this is a prohibition that quite some member states have. We had it, we still have it in Belgium. France also has such a prohibition. And there has already been quite some case law or previous case law on whether such a prohibition is compatible with the Unfair Commercial Practices Directive. So the Unfair Commercial Practices Directive is a full harmonization directive. And so if something is not prohibited in the directive, in the blacklist of the directive, well, member states can't prohibit it in all circumstances. There has been a previous Belgian case in which the question was referred to the European Court of Justice. Belgium has a prohibition for a sale at a loss. Is it compatible with the directive? In that case, the European Court decided, well, full harmonization only applies if something falls within the scope of the directive. And a national rule only falls within the scope of the directive if it's aimed to protect at protecting consumers. If you're only protecting businesses, you're outside the scope, you can do whatever you want, this is not fully harmonized. If this rule also protects consumers, it's within the scope of application of the directive, you can't be more strict than the directive. In the Belgian case, the Court of Justice said, well, it's for the national court to decide what the aim is of this provision. In the Spanish case, it was very clear from the explanatory memorandum that there was at least a double aim, that this was also meant to protect consumers, so this provision cannot withstand the test. This is contrary to the Unfair Commercial Practices Directive. Well, maybe this is a side note, but this is perhaps interesting. So in Belgium, after that European Court decision, the case went back to the national courts, and a decision had to be taken. Look, what is the aim of this provision under Belgian law? And the courts decided there's a double aim, so this provision is not compatible with the Unfair Commercial Practices Directive. Well, a bit perhaps to your surprise, but we still have a prohibition for selling at a loss. What the Belgian legislator has done is that it has changed the ratio legis. It has put in the legislation that it is meant only to protect businesses and not to protect consumers. This way it stays outside the scope of the Unfair Commercial Practices Directive, and we still have a prohibition for sale at a loss in all circumstances. It hasn't been challenged so far, but this is how we have solved this in Belgium. Let's see whether the Spanish authorities will be as, well, creative. The SIM cards I'll come back to in a minute, business premises as well, and in the last case decided on the directive on consumer rights is this Storman case. This considers Article 21 of that directive. That provision actually says that if a trader operates a telephone line for purpose of contacting him in relation to the contract, well, then the consumer, the only costs that can be asked from the consumer is just a basic rate. So there has been some discussion already on what is then a basic rate. And this, again, was a practice that was disputed. This company actually had several numbers. It had a landline, basic rate, and it also had a speed dial number. You could contact, to be contacted by mobile phone, and this was more expensive. But consumers were very well informed, look, we have different numbers, landline, cheaper, speed dial number, more expensive. So this was referred to the European Court of Justice. European Court of Justice has considered it to be contrary to the Consumer Rights Directive. So even if you inform the consumer, if you have several possibilities, you can never charge more than the basic rate. On consumer sales, We haven't had that many cases. One case in last year on the notion of the contract of sale. So we have minimum harmonization at the moment still on consumer sales, which also includes this directive, some contracts that are under many national systems or that weren't used to be considered as contracts of sale. For example, under the directive, certain contracts that also involve supply of services are still considered sales contracts. For example, contracts for the supply of goods that are still have to be manufactured, definitely sales contracts under this directive. Contracts that provide for the installation of such goods, you buy a washing machine, needs to be installed, this is still covered by the directive. So it's very clear from the scope of application of the directive that some contracts that involve certain services are covered. Question now was, how far does this go? Because what the facts were of this case, this considered a contract for a renovation of a swimming pool. So the pool was there, renovation had to be done, some involved the sale of some goods. I think it was a new filtration system with a pump. So the question was, is this then a contract of sale? Does this fall within the scope of application of the directive? And of course, HES says no. If there are services involved, we have to look what is the principal subject. If the supply of goods is ancillary, then it's a services contract. You didn't fall within the scope of application of this directive. It might be protected by national law, but under European law, the protection in case of services is much more limited than in case of the sale of goods. On the Consumer Credits Directive, only the case that I've already mentioned. We also have some case law on payment services, both on the old directive, and that's actually the second case of Razul, concerns scope application of the old payment services directive. There it was decided that terminals that enable cash withdrawals in a gaming arcade are not considered to be payment services. The first case, American Express, is quite technical. Considered the application of certain provisions of the new directive to co-branded products and three-party payment card schemes. Lots of cases on passenger rights. This is a regulation that, well, continues to give rise to discussion, that also gives rise to a lot of litigation, not only by individual consumers, but very often also by companies to which claims are being assigned. Think of flight rights, there's lots of such companies that have been created over the last years. Some interesting case law, I'll briefly mention what this was all about. First case was about what is actually the price of a ticket. So as a consumer, in certain cases, you are entitled under this regulation to reimbursement of the price of your ticket. So this actually wasn't disputed in this case, but the question was, what is exactly this price? Because what happened is that these customers actually bought their tickets on a website, a German website, Opodo, and they traveled, it was Vueling. So they asked for reimbursement. Fine, said the airline company, I'll give you €1,000. You actually pay more than that, but there's a €70 commission. We won't reimburse that. So then the question was, if you have paid this commission as a consumer, can you also ask for reimbursement if you fall under the scope of application of this regulation? So what did the court decide? Try to balance rights of consumers and the rights of the airlines, the operators. So normally, a commission is part of the price unless the commission was paid without the knowledge of the carrier. So if there was no contract or no knowledge of the carrier that this commission was being charged, then it shouldn't be reimbursed by the airline. But normally, it is part of the price of the ticket and it has to be reimbursed. Second case concerned stopover flights in the territory of a non-member state. So we know that this regulation applies to European operators. It also applies to foreign operators if they start from an EU airport. So what happened here is that some customers had a contract with, I think it was Royal Air Maroc. They left from Berlin, they went to Agadir, changed flights there, and then from Agadir to Casablanca. So the question was, does it have to be considered as one flight? Or if you change in a non-EU country, well, are you not protected then in the last part of your flight? Court of Justice took a consumer-friendly approach, it has to be considered as one flight so that consumers are protected. This was Wegner. We have Worth that considered the definition of an operating air carrier. So as a consumer, it's actually the operating carrier. Well, you're entitled to invoke your rights against the operating air carrier. So what happened here, and this is also a practice that occurs actually quite often, it was TUI in this case, and they don't own all their aircrafts. They work with lease contracts. They lease the airplane, but very often also the crew. So this is called wet lease. And so what happened is that they mentioned on the ticket, look, we are working with a lease contract and the actual operating air carrier is another company. So they told the customers, you have to actually file your claim against the operating air carrier. Court of Justice decided that this was not, the company that contracted under the wet lease, but it was actually TUI who had to be considered the operating air carrier. It had the contract with the customer, and it was also TUI that decided where where this flight had to go to. It was fixing the itinerary, it was fixing the performance of the flight. This was all determined by TUI Fly. So TUI Fly had to be considered the operating air carrier, and whether you mention something on a ticket or not, this does not change anything. More protection for consumers in Cruiseman and others. Wildcat strike actions, so spontaneous organizations or spontaneous actions by a number of your personnel that do not want to work. Is this extraordinary circumstances? In which case consumers are not entitled to compensation? No, these are not extraordinary circumstances. Consumers remain entitled to compensation even if the flight is late or cancelled because of spontaneous absence of a part of your crew. More cases, these are the last two cases on passenger rights. Consumers are quite creative in applying this regulation, not only the airlines. What happened in this Boston case, this concerned a flight from Brussels to Rome. And it stopped in Hamburg. So there were some problems. Consumers were entitled to compensation. And as you know, compensation is higher if your distance is longer. So the consumer said, look, we had to go to Rome. This was about 1,300 kilometers, but if you really look how we were flying, this was 1,600 kilometers, first to Hamburg and then to Rome, so we're entitled to extra compensation. So again, this went to the Court of Justice. Court of Justice says, no, look, it's not because you had a different route, this covers for damages because you were late, it's not because you had a stopover that you're necessarily harmed, or your harm was more important than if you had a direct flight. The only thing we look at is start destination, final destination, and it doesn't matter how far you actually flew. And the last case, I won't go into detail, this concerns private international law, the place of performance, where also some clarifications have been given in very specific situations. Because so you have to move on. I'm still not still discussing these cases. I'm not actually discussing going into detail, so I'll try to go a bit further, a bit faster. E-commerce, two cases on the directive of 2000. One case that has already received lots of attention the Spanish Uber case, quite an important case, because Uber was arguing there, look what we are doing, that's an information society service, and it has lots of implications. So under the e-commerce directive, what member states can actually impose in terms of license requirements to providers of information society services is far more limited than if you do not qualify as an information society service provider. What the court said there is, look, what you're doing, so an intermediation service, yeah, this can perfectly well be an information society service, but in your specific case, what you're doing is much more than just intermediation. You are also determining to a major extent the price. You have a control on the quality of the vehicles. You have a control on the drivers and their conduct. What you're doing is essentially transport service, with all the implications, implications for the possibilities for member states to impose additional requirements. First case concerns limitations of liability. So the e-commerce directive also has some provisions on exclusions, limitations of liability for providers of certain information society services, inter alia for hosting providers, but the court there mainly repeated its previous case law. So if your role is passive, you fall under the exception. If you have an active role, and such an active role could be by allowing customers to optimize their sales, then you don't fall within the scope of application of this exception. Oh, another interesting case. This considers very specific provisions on protected designations of origin. Here, protection of champagne as a designation of origin. And this, Comité Interprofessionnel du Vin Champagne is very active in protecting champagne. So what happens here is that they started a case, an action against Aldi, who was selling sorbet, ice cream, that actually contained 12% champagne as champagne sorbet. And so this regulation says that, well, if you use such a protected designation of origin for a non-comparable product, this can be prohibited if what you do is actually an exploitation of the reputation of this protected designation of origin. And in order to determine whether in such a case you have an exploitation, well, what is the criterion? So you can't take undue advantage of the reputation of the product. So if you use it as an ingredient, this is as such not sufficient to say there's no exploitation. If you use it as a product, you still have to check as a national court whether it's added in a sufficient quantity to really make sure that it's an essential characteristic. And how do you know whether 12% is sufficient or not? It's the taste. So I don't know how the national court has to determine this, but the Court of Justice says, look, you have to look at all the evidence you have and you have to determine, this is the determining characteristic, you have to determine whether the taste is really determined by this ingredient, and then if that is the case, there is no exploitation and you can continue to call your sorbet champagne sorbet. Okay, this is also very briefly, this considers organic production and labeling regulation, concept of direct sale. What was this about? There is an exception in this regulation. In case of a direct sale, then certain control system doesn't apply to such sellers. So the question was whether internet sale is also a direct sale. European Court of Justice said no. This is really an exception. If we would also consider internet sale to be a direct sale, then control would not be applied to a huge sector. This is not the case. Scotch Whisky Association, I'll come back to. And then the last case I briefly wanted to mention, then you have all the cases of the last year, is a case, it was on genetically modified mice, and it concerns the situations in which member states could actually ask the Commission to take, to adopt emergency measures. All right, And then the most interesting cases for last year, apart from the ones that were already mentioned. Unfair contract terms. This case concerns Romanian contracts. Cases are a bit different from the ones, the case is a bit different from the ones we've had before. This also concerned the foreign currency loan. In the Hungarian cases, we had loans that had to be paid back in the Hungarian currency, but there was a reference to the Swiss franc to determine the amount of the installments. In this case, the installments also had to be paid in Swiss francs. So there were a number of questions asked to the courts. First question is actually, how do we apply this general norm? What circumstances can be taken into account? So we have to look if there's an imbalance. At what point in time should we decide as a national court? Time of conclusion of the contract? Or can we also look at what happens later? The court has decided we have to look at time of conclusion of the contract to assess whether a contract term is unfair. There are some national systems that go further, if I'm not mistaken, some Scandinavian systems that also allow courts to look at what has happened since the conclusion of the contract to determine whether a contract term is unfair. This is not the system of the directive. The directive allows to control whether the contract is concluded in good faith, but if there are certain circumstances that could have been known to the supplier, that are of such a nature that they could affect the future performance of the contract, they have to be taken into account. So if the trader should have foreseen that a certain term could create over time an imbalance, this can be taken into account to consider a term unfair. Second element that was discussed is a transparency element. There has also been lots of case law on that. So the Directive on Unfair Contract Terms actually says that contract terms have to be in plain and intelligible language. If this is not the case, the directive doesn't say this explicitly, but if this is not the case, this is an element that can be taken into account to consider a clause unfair. What does this mean? We already had some case law on that. It doesn't only mean grammatically intelligible, but it also means that the economic consequences of a term have to be clear to the average consumer. So if the consumer reads that term, not only grammatically it has to be clear, but the economic consequences also have to be clear. So this was applied here in a bit more detail. So the actual effects have to be clear to the average consumer. And in this case of such a contract, and the average consumer has to be aware of the possibility of a rise or a fall in the value of the foreign currency. So the risk has to be very clear to the consumer. Another issue that was discussed here, as you know, not all contract terms can be controlled by courts. So some are excluded, the core contract terms. The court has in the past given a rather strict interpretation on what is a core contract term. It really has to lay down an essential obligation of a contract. It has to characterize the contract. So in these Hungarian cases, where these foreign currency loans were indexed with reference to a foreign currency, well, if I read that court case, I wouldn't consider this to be a core contract term. This is a different case, and the court explicitly distinguishes this case from Kassler, the Hungarian case. So here, there was no indexing and no reference to the foreign currency, but these installments were in a foreign currency. So in such a case, this is an essential obligation. This is a core contract term. In principle, it cannot be controlled by the court for unfairness unless it's not drafted in plain and intelligible language. And then we come back to what just has been said. If the economic consequences aren't clear, it can be controlled anyway. More cases on unfair contract terms. This is one where, this is a Belgian case where the legal department of our university was a little bit concerned How do we have to interpret this? Are we now undertakings as a university or as students consumers? Do we have to change our contracts? We probably do. So this is a case, it didn't concern KU Leuven, but it concerned a different Belgian educational institution. And there had been problems with the student, with the payment not only of the registration fee, but also a study trip. And so what happened, there was a contract, an interest-free plan for repayment with a quite high interest rate. So a case was brought before the courts, and some questions were raised. Maybe I'll first deal with this one. Is university a seller in the sense of this directive? Does it have to comply with this directive, and can unfair contract terms be controlled? The court decided that in this case, well, this was just an ancillary service, it didn't concern subsidized provision of subsidized education, there could be no discussion. This is definitely a seller in the sense of the directive, so the directive applies. It did not give a clear answer on whether this would also be the case if this really concerned the core activities of university, providing subsidized education. In my opinion, previous case law of the court, BKK Mobil Oil, decided in the framework of the Unfair Commercial Practices Directive, has already given a very broad interpretation on what is an undertaking in the framework of that directive. It doesn't matter if you're a non-profit institution or not. It doesn't matter whether you pursue a task in the public interest or not. So statutory health insurance funds or undertakings, they have to comply with consumer law. In my opinion, this probably also applies to universities, but this has a more limited, what the court decided here is a bit more limited in scope. Well, something else that was decided here, under Belgian law, if a judgment is given in default, the judge can only invoke a provision ex officio, of its own initiative, if this is a public policy provision. That's the Belgian rule, very clear. We also have case law saying that unfair contract terms are just mandatory law provisions. Protecting private interests, they do not concern public policy. That's the Belgian case law. So the question was here, can a judge deciding giving a judgment in default, can or must such a judge invoke ex officio unfair contract terms? Well, there had already been some, well, this provision had already been discussed by some legal writers, and the court has now given the same answer. Yes, such a court, even giving judgment in default, it must raise unfair contract terms legislation and also other consumer protection legislation of its own motion. The Court of Justice had already decided in previous case law that consumer law provisions must be given the same treatment as rules of public policy. So even if you consider them nationally to be just mandatory, you still have to give them the same treatment as public policy provisions. So we have to invoke them ex officio. Okay, more cases on unfair contract terms. I'll have to speed up a little bit. A Spanish case again. Many of these consumers can't actually reimburse their mortgages, can't pay their installments. So what happens is that these contracts are being assigned to other undertakings, to third parties, for further enforcement. And the question was, does the directive on unfair contract terms apply to such a practice? The Court of Justice has said that it doesn't. This does not change the position of the consumer. It still has the same contractual rights. Full contract is being assigned to a third party. Also, the directive on unfair contract terms only deals with terms, not with practices. So the Court of Justice makes a clear distinction between terms, and unfair practices. Distinction that is not always made at a national level, but is still being made, well, at least for these instruments. I don't know if you're familiar with the recent proposal for a directive on B2B, unfair commercial practices, and there you see that unfair terms and unfair practices are being mingled and dealt with in the same instrument, but not with this directive. Second question that was being referred, and it is also, well, the relevance is broader than just this case. So what happened in Spain, having so many cases dealing with interest rates and default interest rates that were really high, and all these national courts had to decide when an interest rate was too high. And so the Supreme Court actually gave some guidance and said that if the default interest rate was more than 2% of the ordinary interest rate, then that was an unfair term. So now there was a question, is such guidance by the national courts, is this contrary to the directive? No, says the European Court of Justice, this is perfectly fine. This case law came about using the guidelines of the European Court of Justice. It would be problematic if a lower court could no longer assess whether a term is unfair if this did not meet these criteria. But it is not problematic to give guidance as a national Supreme Court, which is, I think, a logical decision. A last question that is also an important one, at least in Belgium, we don't really know how to deal with all this case law of the Court of Justice, dealing with the consequences of declaring a term unfair. So the Court of Justice has decided that if a term is unfair in a contract, then the national courts have to decide that this term is not binding. They cannot reduce it. And even applying the supplementary legal provision can only be done if otherwise the whole contract would have to be declared void and this would be negative for the consumer. If this is not the case, it's not so evident, you can't just apply supplementary law. There has to be a deterrent effect, the clause has to be declared void. This is about supplementary legislation. The question here was, we have these very high default interest rates, 20%, etc. These contracts also have interest rates, ordinary interest rates, a remuneration for the capital you take out. These were considered valid. So the question was, if you declare this very high interest, default interest rate void, can you still apply as a court the contractual clause with the normal interest rate? That is fine, says the court. If those clauses are not considered void, you can still continue to apply them. This is not contrary to our previous case law. Too many cases. Last one on unfair contract terms, promissory note. Just briefly, because this is a practice that is perhaps being used in quite some countries, and the Belgian law, this is prohibited. So this Polish practice also concerns credit agreements, and so what happened is that consumers had to sign a promissory note. The advantage for a bank is that if the consumer doesn't pay, it goes to the court with a promissory note, and then you have a two-stage process. So in the first stage, the court just has to check, is this formally valid? Okay, then I declare it enforceable. Consumer can object, and only in a second stage, the court can look at the underlying relationship and at the unfair terms. So the question was, is this compatible with the Unfair Contract Terms Directive? At stage one, you can't check as a court whether there are unfair terms. At stage two, you can. Well, the court said in principle, this is not in all circumstances contrary to your right to an effective remedy. But in these specific circumstances, it is. Because as a consumer, the circumstances in which you have to object after this first stage, are too cumbersome. Costs are too high, time limits are too short. This puts a burden on the consumer, and it restricts the consumer's right to an effective remedy. Okay, so there you have all the details. Very briefly still? Very briefly, okay. Unfair commercial practices. What can I tell? This is about the energy labels on vacuum cleaners. Yeah, it's actually an interesting case because, well, you know the energy labels, AA, plus, etc. So these are some space to make it easier for consumers to make their decision. So what this particular provider had done, so they put the required energy label, but then they also put other labels. So we have an official AAA+, but then they put an extra green label, energy A. It's correct, but it was also already in the official label. So this was disputed by Dyson. Another thing that Dyson said, look, you put the energy label, but this is actually tested in a situation with an empty dust bag. We don't use dust bags. So if we have this energy label, this is correct for us during the whole, well, every time you use your vacuum cleaner. If you have a vacuum cleaner with a dust bag, once the dust bag is filled, you use more energy. You should mention that. So those two practices were actually challenged. So first question is, should that other vacuum cleaning producer, should they mention, look, our vacuum cleaners are tested with an empty bag, and actually if you use them long enough, you will use more power, although this is not required by the EU legislation. The court said, no, this is not a misleading omission in the sense of the Unfair Commercial Practices Directive. This regulation provides what the essential information is. You might question whether those tests are then done correctly, but it's not a misleading omission. Second question, can you use additional labels giving the same information very briefly? Is that misleading? Is that prohibited? Yes. It may confuse end users. Well, at least it's for the national court to decide, but the guidance the European Court of Justice gave, well, is quite detailed, and there is a risk of confusion, of a misleading practice if one provider has additional labels and the others do not have this. This is also a case still on the Unfair Commercial Practices Directive. We haven't had that many cases on the blacklist. And this concerns inertia selling. So what happened here is these two companies, they sold SIM cards. And actually, they came together with some preloaded and pre-activated functionality. So you could go on the internet, but then you also had to pay for it. And this wasn't clearly mentioned to the consumers at first. So they had to take some active steps in order to incur these extra costs. So the question was, is this then an unsolicited service? Is this really, does this also include this blacklisted practice, such a conduct? And the court said yes. Blacklisted practices are prohibited in all circumstances. You don't have to check as a court whether there is an influence on the behavior of the consumer. But of course, as a court, you will still have to determine first, is this really inertia selling? Is this really demanding payment for something that was not solicited? And in order to determine whether you fall within the scope of application of this blacklisted practice, you do have to look, according to the Court of Justice, what the average consumer's behavior is. Would the average consumer know if he buys such a SIM card? Would the average consumer be aware that he might incur additional costs? If that is not the case, it's inertia selling. So, well, I think this is interesting because this blacklist is supposed to be very clear, and the court does not really have to, has no discretion whether to prohibit something or not. But the criteria, whether you fall within the blacklist or not always, may require an assessment anyway. It still requires an assessment of the behavior or actually of what the average consumer might think if he buys such a product. Scotch whiskey, yeah, I'll have to go in too much detail, I suppose. It's an interesting case, though, very, very briefly. It's actually a German producer of whiskey, and what did they do? They designated, or they sold their whiskey under designation Glen Buchenbach. And Glen, well, it's very often used in combination with Scotch whiskey. It's actually refers to valley. So the discussion there was, is this also an infringement of this regulation that protects geographical indications? I was just, advise you to read the case. The court gives a very strict interpretation and a very broad protection to these geographical indications. It's sufficient that it actually evokes an association with that protected indication. You don't have to use the same words, you don't have to use the same visuals. An evocation, if the consumer, if he sees Glen, has a direct link with the Scotch whisky, that's sufficient for there to be an infringement. Well, it's a bit simplified, but a broad range of protection given to those protected designations. And then the last case I still want to mention, because it is a case that surprised me a bit. It concerns, again, the Consumer Rights Directive and actually, doorstep selling outside business premises. So we have two situations in which the consumer gets a right of withdrawal, distance selling, or if you sell outside normal business premises. So this is defined in the directive. So what are business premises? When do you sell outside your business premises? If it's an immovable retail premises, so a business premise is somewhere where you carry out your activity on a permanent basis, if we're talking about immovable retail premises, or, says the directive, on a usual basis, if we're talking about a movable retail premises. So either permanent, on a permanent basis, or on a usual basis. So this actually concerns contracts concluded at a trade fair, and that fair was only held for a couple of days a year. In such situations, under Belgian law until now, we have always considered that these are contracts concluded outside the normal business premises. You're not there on a permanent basis, you're not there on a usual basis. This is not the interpretation that the European Court of Justice gave. And the European Court of Justice said, look, what is this directive about? It's actually about protecting the consumer when he's surprised. When someone's at your doorstep, you're surprised and you haven't done any research, you don't know the prices, you're surprised, you have to be protected by a right of withdrawal. Well, what we have to look at, actually, these terms usual or permanent are being used, but what you actually should look at, is this a normal place of business? Does the consumer assume when he goes there that the trader will carry out his activity there and will solicit him in order to conclude a contract? So if the average consumer will not be surprised that he solicited on such a trade fair, well, then this is not a contract concluded outside of business premises, and then you will not have a right of withdrawal. This is actually interesting because in Belgium, so we used to apply this legislation also to these trade fairs. In Belgium, every year we have a car trade fair that is very popular. And what we have seen in the last years, because legislation changed, so before it used to be the case if you concluded the contract there, you had 7 days to withdraw. This was fine, this was perfectly manageable. Under the Consumer Rights Directive, the rules have also changed for doorstep selling. The right of the period for withdrawal for goods only starts when the goods are delivered. And for cars, this can be 4 or 5 months later. So this does not work at all for these companies. So what we have seen in Belgium is that contracts are no longer actually concluded on those fairs. They just give information to consumers and they ask them to go to the garage, to the usual business premise to sign the contract there, and there's no right of withdrawal. So we'll be able to change that practice again, conclude contracts at such a fair, because on the basis of this decision, this is not considered to be a contract outside of business premises. So thank you very much for your attention. Quite a lot of cases to mention, but you can all read them in more detail. Thank you.